What's going on, everyone? It's Nick here with Exploring Project Bad. Today I'm with my friend Sean. Y'all remember him from Landonia. Well, guess what? He found a missile silo, knows the guy, and got us in. We got some walking to do. Sean got us a treat today. Say what's up, Sean.
What's up, guys?
Woo! Let's get this.
The removal of 4 tons of sand from the emergency escape hatch.
Welcome to the Lawn Atlas Missile Base. This is a 8.6 acre property. It's one of 72 identical sites nationwide. They were deployed in groups of 12 with a sponsoring or a hosting SAC base built in 1961, operational from 1962 through 1965. And this is a typical site in terms of its deserted condition. It's a rough site, so we've worked hard to maintain access to the site, and incrementally we're trying to get it to the point where it can become a public interpretation site for Cold War history. The site's typified by the silo cap, and this is one reason why these sites are so unknown, is because we're standing on the roof of an 18 and a half story building, but the building's buried, and most folks are totally oblivious to the fact that these magnificent, huge manifestations of state-of-the-art architecture and engineering technology even exist. So what our mission is to call attention to these remarkable structures, to preserve one and have a public interpretation site. And we'd like to do that by returning to the site one of the two 40 by 100 foot Quonset hangars, and having that as basically a surface museum or a public interpretation site, and make this site the first 20th century fort occupying its role in contemporary military history with the frontier forts that are part of the Texas Forts Trail.
All right, guys, you guys are about to see a in-depth interview and story behind the Cold War missile silos, the Atlas sites and the Titan missiles from back in the day.
These sites were fully active by the time of the Cuban Missile Crisis. And this was President Eisenhower's number one defense agenda, was to create our first intercontinental ballistic missile system. So the format that we take for granted today was created by the Atlas F. And the reason these are the largest silos ever built is because this missile was a liquid-fueled ICBM. So they had to protect and co-locate with the missile all the liquid propellants, the oxidizers, the diesel fuels for running the generators and all the systems associated with the missile. And these are massive structures, 383,000 cubic feet.
This guy is amazing. What he's doing is for everybody, which is really cool. He's not just holding it for himself. He's working hard on it. And we're going to give a little bit of help with him after we're done with this film.
Boom. Here we go. We're in the approach area for the crew entrapment area. And just like a sally gate at the entrance to a prison, this door is always locked. So the commander of the crew of five, when they arrive for their 24-hour shift, there's a telephone right here, he would lift, they give the code word of the day, and then this door would be remotely unlocked by the on-site commander. The entire crew of five, with their provisions for their 24-hour shift, would then walk into the entrapment area. And there was another door structure here, identical to the first one. Both would be locked, and then the commander again would lift the phone, give the word of the day, to which the commander on site would respond with the number. And that number had to be added by the arriving commander with another number to equal the number of the day. And this was the safe way to make sure that that crew was not arriving here with a threat. Right. So if an individual had basically put a gun to the commander's head and brought them in here, all he had to do to blow the whistle on that threat is respond with the wrong number. And that was the automatic clue for the team on site to notify the security team to come here and address that threat.
Man, oh, look at that blast door.
Now, after you come through the second entrapment area door, you would encounter what they refer to as the vestibule, and the first of two one-ton manganese steel blast doors. And these doors were designed when the site was active in such a way that you could only open one of these one-ton manganese steel blast doors at a time. And keeping one of these doors closed at all times guaranteed the safety of the crew in the launch control center. And remarkable in terms of their ability to resist external pressures. And you also note that as we enter the launch control center, we'll negotiate four right angle turns. And each of these right angle turns are here for two reasons. First of all, every time there's a right angle turn, there's a dramatic reduction in overpressure that could be placed on these blast doors by a thermonuclear explosion. And the second reason for the right angle turns is radiation can only move in straight lines. So the right angle turns guarantee that the team on site would never be exposed to the radiation from a near strike thermonuclear explosion.
Let me go down. Not just a hole in the ground here.
Let me turn the lights on.
It's a vintage 1960s Coca-Cola.
Yeah, 20 cents. Dude, that is insane. That is the best looking one I have came across. I've been in two silos and already this silo is amazing. The other silo is full of water up to here.
Yeah, this wasn't like that, but he had a new pump in there that he uses. Look down.
Oh yeah.
Come on down.
This is so cool. Oh wow. Just get a whole wide range of this.
Position. And of course that tube would have been filled with 4 tons of masonry sand and designed in such a way that with this offset release mechanism, it would keep you in a safe position to release that door and then dump 4 tons of sand onto the floor. The removal of 4 tons of sand from the emergency escape hatch was a real dilemma, because we could have easily opened the hatch and dumped 4 tons of sand on the floor and then cleaned that up and carried it out one bucket at a time. Or another approach would have been to remove it from the top down, but an adult in that narrow tube can't bend over or work or do anything. So my solution was inviting my 10-year-old son, Keith, to work with Regina, my wife, and from the top down, with a Pringle potato chip tube and a bucket, they could pick up sand, lift it up, lower it, and over the course of approximately 3 weekends, they were able to remove by hand from the top down 4 tons of masonry sand. And that saved me a lot of backbreaking work. Anyway, my neighbors who have done a similar approach of removing the sand had just dumped theirs on the floor, and that's a lot of work that I was glad to avoid.
Right on. Well, thank you, Keith, for getting to the spot where we couldn't, because that is definitely what I was wondering, how you would get that out. But you painted this picture right here?
Oh, my. I could not find a really good shot of a launch in large scale. So this was a painting I finished decades ago, showing a launch of a Atlas F from an Atlas F silo. And I've heard from folks that have witnessed these launches from Vandenberg Air Force Base that an Atlas launch is extremely exciting, very, very dynamic in terms of fire, and it's just an exciting launch to witness.
Right on. So you've been to the Valhalla dive one, and you dove there twice?
Dive Valhalla is a phenomenal investment on Mark Hanifin's part. He's done a wonderful job in creating a venue there for high adventure scuba or just special certifications. Keep in mind that his site is identical to mine in terms of its water depth. We're at altitude here, so you can get your special high altitude diving certification and a number of other special certifications through Mark Hanathan's dive shop in Midland. And he's, again, done a fantastic job creating a very, very exciting venue for scuba in the middle of West Texas, which is a very unique
that's unheard of.
Mix of activities in this region. So,
man, that's amazing. So I definitely know where I'm going to go get my diving license at for high altitude and all that. Jeez, in the middle of West Texas, you can get that. Unheard of. I don't think there's any state like that in the middle of a desert.
We're on level one of the Launch Control Center, and level one was called the Ready Room, and this is where the crew would live when they weren't not actually involved in maintenance or other activities in the silo or at the second level where all the actual launch controls were located. And on level one, they had three bunk beds, they had a full kitchen, bathrooms, showers, all the luxuries of a ICBM base.
This is a diagram of the Atlas F4 plan. So right now we are over in here and we're about to work our way down, and that's where the missile will be, right there. That is impressive.
And then the stairwell, level one and level two, we're gonna go down the stairwell eventually to the tunnel that will connect us directly to the silo.
Can't wait.
And then one last shot here that is a really good 3D representation of the entire site. You've probably never seen that before.
No, I have not. Oh man, my friend Ryan right now, he's gonna be kicking me. I got it on the picture. I can slide it in with the power of editing. Oh wow. So were these rusted out at all?
Oh yeah, horribly. And of course, they did rust continuously, but the first thing we did here was sandblast the entire stairwell and then paint it. Humidity and time continued to do their nasty work.
Yeah.
Tell them about the no lung zone.
Oh, let's elaborate on that when we go back up, because okay, that's really a neat aspect.
Oh wow.
Okay, and this, although it doesn't resemble anything you saw in that other picture, the left half, if you imagine extending the walls to the floor, I cut those out to open up the space for greater access and greater utility of the space. But when those walls were here, everything on the left side was where the crew of five actually operated the launch of an Atlas ICBM. And you can relate to that photograph that you looked at earlier. This space here was the location of the launch panel with the commander sitting on the left side, the vice commander sitting on the right, the lockbox orders located in a safe in this position, adjacent to the control panel for the power generation specialist. And that was a full-time position on the site because the generation of power is extremely important to accomplish the mission, because there was no connectivity between the missile base and the grid, because the grid acts as a attractor and a communicator of electromagnetic pulse. And they could not permit that, because a single burst anywhere over continental United States would fry every transistor, every circuit in the entire nation instantaneously.
Wow.
So it was incumbent upon this mission to maintain total independence from that system. And that's why the power generation was so important. We had the communications equipment located right here, and then a technical sergeant was responsible for making sure everything was operational 24/7. Now, one physical characteristic that's really unique about the Launch Control Center, level two, is this steel wall, which creates a building within the building. And it's this steel wall that guaranteed the insulation of all the electronics here from electromagnetic pulse. So this comprises what's referred to as a Faraday box. And just like the Faraday suits that the technicians wear when they're working on high power lines, it allows the transmission
of EMP around the sites into grounding infrastructure outside the launch control center, and it guarantees, again, a different level of guaranteed protection against EMP threat of an initial strike from a thermonuclear weapon. Okay, we're exactly 45 feet underground now at this level. And this is the tunnel, the 40-foot tunnel that connects the launch control center to the actual silo. Come on down, step up and step down. And straight ahead.
Another glass door right here, check it out. And that's the ongoing battle against rust, especially down in here.
And these are manganese, one-ton manganese blast doors, just like we went through to enter the launch control center. But these blast doors are here to protect the crew from an exploding Atlas.
Oh, whoa. Look at this, guys. This is everything. You still have the flooring too. That's insane. So how deep is that right there, you think?
I'd say somewhere in the neighborhood of 155 feet. So you're not even looking at a sixth of the silo here. It's all underwater.
18 stories. Look at that.
Oh yeah.
And the water is beautiful, clear, potable.
Yeah, it looks like you can almost see to the bottom, like it's not even that deep.
If we had a really high intensity submersible light, we could literally lower it to the bottom and illuminate the entire structure. I'd love to do that as soon as possible.
Have you ever thought about throwing glow sticks down there?
Oh.
Done it?
Yes, we've done that many times, but they disappear too soon.
Right. I mean, just seeing it going down would just give the effect to let people know, like, hey, it looks safe, but that is deeper. Lake Fort
and this water is coming up continuously. In fact, the structure I'm standing on right now, you raise the hatch, you can go down 10 feet to an OSHA standard offset, then down 30 feet to the next platform with an OSHA standard offset, and then down 30 more feet at the bottom of which that structure, you would step off of it onto my dive platform. Well, over the last 17 years, the water has come up and enveloped all of that structure I was talking about. So I've lost about 50 to 55 feet of ladder structure just by rising water. And that has to be managed.
In the last 17 years that's happened.
Yeah, and that's coming up continuously. And if I don't do something about that, much like the sites that we talked about that have been taken over by water, that's exactly what'll happen to our launch control center if this water rise is not managed.
Yeah, have you ever pumped it out yet? Or
no, I've just purchased a submersible pump system, and then with the new power panel and the electrical service, I'll be able to initiate that process. What you're looking at inside the silo are the four massive mounts that supported six stories of massive coil springs that were attached to the silo crib at level six. And these coil springs allowed the entire 18 and a half story crib, the steel structure, to bounce up and down inside the silo in the event of a nuclear attack. And that guaranteed the safety of the missile, all of the supporting mechanical equipment, the massive holding tanks for the liquid oxygen and the RP-1 kerosene propellant, and the large diesel storage tanks that were located at the bottom of the silo. So all that was independent of the 9-foot thick walls that surround us at this level.
9-foot thick walls.
Removed it because I think that's a part of the history of the place now. And someday I hope I can find out
who they are.
Who these people. Now, especially, I want to find out who Bud was or is.
Or how he even got there.
He was a adventurer with cojones, and that.
So imagine after the morning of the Cuban Missile Crisis, the soldiers who were stationed here on DEFCON 2, they finally finished their shift after not having to end the world. They can walk up the steps and see the sunlight.
Now when the world just didn't end, because they'd be one of the last few ones left in a nuclear holocaust.
They would have been one of the ones to end the world. Having a gun pointed to your head, so if they tell you to press the button, you're going to press the button, or I'm going to blow your brains out.
Yeah, that's insane.
All right, guys, we are done with this adventure right here in the silo. Larry was an awesome dude. Let us come in. It is bright outside. I can barely see. Again, thank you for adventuring with us. This is Exploring Project Bad, and I'm your boy, Nick. Whoa.
These are the two 70-ton doors that were required to protect the Atlas ICBM as it was nested in the silo. But these doors would open very rapidly to allow the missile to come to the surface for deployment.